Information technology progresses exponentially. It doubles in power every year. That means multiplying by a factor of 1,000 in 10 years. And it's every aspect of information technology, computers, communication networks, memory, even biological technologies. And it leads to surprising results. So you can buy $1 million of computation circa 1990 today for $1. But people get used to it very quickly, and we create new applications, like social networks didn't exist 5 years ago because now they're cost effective. People didn't use search engines 15 years ago because they were too expensive. Now they're very inexpensive. This ongoing exponential growth creates new opportunities, and most economic growth comes from the new opportunities created by this exponential growth. We already have computers we can put inside your brain or connect into your brain. Like if you have Parkinson's disease, you can have a computer connected right into your brain and you can download new software to that computer and it restores some of the functionality that you lost. So that's just today. As these computers get more and more powerful, smaller and smaller, as we can actually send them in through the bloodstream with no surgery required, they'll become more and more popular. If you go out 30 years, we're all going to be making ourselves smarter by putting these computers in our bodies and brains. They'll keep us healthy from inside. They'll go inside our brains. They'll put our brains out in the cloud of computing. We'll have vast resources directly from our brain. But even if we have a computer in our hand, even if it's not inside our brain today, it is making us smarter. I have access to all human knowledge, and so do 30% of Africans walk around with these brain extenders. We could not keep up with the explosion of knowledge if it wasn't for the brain extenders we already have. The computer I carry on my belt enables me to access all of human knowledge. We have all these tools that allow us to find exactly what we need. If that weren't the case, we couldn't keep up with it today. So our tools enable us to create the knowledge, to store it, to find it, to access it intelligently, and that's going to continue to be the case. Norbert Wiener wrote the book Cybernetics in 1948, the year I was born, and it was one of my favorite books because it talks about how there will be tremendous impact of information technology in every facet of life. And this is what I talk about also. We see it spawning revolutions around the world. We see it enabling new medical breakthroughs. We see it growing the world economy, spreading education so a kid in Africa can take a course of high-quality university materials from France or from the United States over the internet. This is the kind of world that's being created, and every aspect of life is being affected. I'm generally optimistic, but I'm also very aware of the dangers. We've always used technology for good and for destruction. Fire kept us warm, but also burned down our villages. These new technologies are very powerful. For example, biotechnology can help cure disease and cancer, but it could also be used by a bioterrorist to create a new biological weapon. The answer is we have to work on technologies that will keep them safe. And we can put in, for example, a rapid response system, a technological immune system that would detect new problems and counteract them. We have that, by the way, for software viruses. We need to do that for biological viruses and for all of these new dangers that these technologies will bring. So I'm very mindful of the dangers, and I think we need to work on them. But overall, I'm optimistic that it helps us more than it hurts us. If you look at human life a few hundred years ago, read Thomas Hobbes. He describes well how desperate, poor, disease-filled, disaster-prone human life was. It was very difficult. Human life expectancy was 37 in 1800. It turns out that the exponential growth of these different measures of information technology is very predictable. The amount of computation you can get per euro, or the number of bits of communication, or biological technologies, the cost of that, it doubles in price performance every year, and we can predict that. So maybe your project isn't quite feasible today, but you can calculate that it will be feasible in 3 years. And if you start your project now, you'll finish it in 3 years and sort of meet the train at the station. And that's what I do. That's why I got into this forecasting. I'm principally an inventor, and I wanted to be able to time my inventions. And you can't work on the world that you see in front of you. You have to work on the world that will exist 3 years from now. Look at how different the world was 3 years ago. There were no social networks, no wikis, no blogs. 12 years ago, people didn't use search engines. So the world changes very quickly, but you can predict certain aspects of that. Well, I've actually started in reading technology. I created the first reading machine for the blind 35 years ago. I'm continuing to work on that technology to bring the world of reading to everyone in every language, whether they have reading problems or not. I have a reading project called Blio, which is actually free. It's available today, and we're adding more and more intelligence to that. My big grand project is artificial intelligence, to recreate human intelligence in a machine. And I have some actual ideas about how human intelligence works, what the fundamental mechanisms in the human brain that allow us to be intelligent. I'm going to describe those in my book, which is called How the Mind Works and How to Build One. And then I want to work on artificial intelligence to actually create intelligent machines that can help us to be smarter. And I've actually been working on that for 50 years.